Long-term memory, in and of itself, we've got a couple different kinds of long-term memory we're going to talk about. Explicit memory. It's not rated X, it's just explicit. But if you think about rated X being explicit, explicit lyrics, right? Y'all remember those little parental advisory warnings? That's a mnemonic to help you remember it. Explicit memory is declarative memory, which means it's a conscious memory for specific facts. You could also say, I do declare that yesterday I... God, what did I do yesterday? I had two pot pies last night. I do declare that last night I had two pot pies. They're little ones. And they're made by Marie Callender. I do declare that because I have a specific conscious memory of it. It could be episodic or it could be semantic. Episodic, the way I think of that, is an episode. So what did you do with your friends on Friday night? That was an episode. Last week, I went to Legoland with my brother and my son and my little niece. We went to Legoland for whom? The niece, the 8-year-old. We had fun hanging out with the 8-year-old who had fun going to Legoland. And there was some pretty cool stuff at Legoland, and I remember some of it. In fact, I could tell you a bit about that episode of my life. If you think about sitcoms, what are they? Little segments of people's lives, right? So to the degree that you can tell me or recount something that happened to you, whether it's 2 minutes or 5 minutes or all day, that would be an episodic memory. Where, when, how? Specific events, specific situations, personally relevant to you. I can't tell you what you did on that day because I don't know. But to the degree that I'm able to remember it and declare it to you, it's a episodic, declarative, explicit memory. Semantic memory would be the idea of remembering ideas, rules, concepts about the world, generalizations, experiences, and knowledge. So when you have people who are arguing about whether or not to use a comma right here, right, what are they arguing about? Whether they remember correctly what the rules of grammar are, right? I think you use a comma here. I don't think you use a comma there. That's a semantic rule-based memory that we are not only just using without thinking about it, but if you think about it, if you make it conscious and you start talking about what rules are or how we do things, right? Then you're talking about semantic memory. We all engage in all kinds of behavior that has patterns to it that are rule-based patterns. And as such, we're oftentimes not conscious of them, but we can become conscious of them at any given time, right? And that would make it an explicit memory. So if you can make it conscious, then it would be declarative. And many declarative memories are both, because you remember things like, oh, I was waiting in line at Legoland. Why waiting in line? Well, that's the rule for getting on the ride. So waiting in line is both an episodic memory that I remember, and it's part of my rule-based behavior that I engaged in while I was at Legoland, because I was able to remember both of those factors. They are conscious memories, explicit memories, declarative memories. So a lot of our memories are really a little of both of these. A lot of times we act without being conscious. And those are implicit memories, non-declarative, when you don't even know why you did something, but you did it. Well, I did it because I thought I should do it. Why? I don't know, I just did. Sometimes we're not even aware that we do it. Most of the time I would say we're not aware of things we do. Unconscious memories. Well, that's Freudian, isn't it? That's talking about the deep unconscious. Yes, it is. Well, Freud wasn't a fool. It turns out that we do a lot of things without being aware of them. Think about it. You go through your day being aware of everything you do, you're going to be not doing very much, right? Don't you drive without having to remember every little thing about driving? You just kind of get in and do it. Now, you could become explicitly aware of what you're doing. You could say, I got in the seat, I grabbed the steering wheel, I inserted the key or pushed the button these days, right? I checked the mirrors, I put it into gear, I moved out. But normally, you just drive the car. And as such, we can be influenced by memories we're not aware of. In a lot of facets of our life, we are. So for procedural memory, we're talking about perceptual, motor, cognitive skills required to complete a task. If you're a run a register, for example, And anybody, how many people run a register in here? Y'all ever run a register? The first time you do it, it's a little tricky, isn't it? You're looking for all these keys to see where little things are that you need to ring up. But the better and better you get at it, the more it goes from being explicit to implicit, that you can just do it pretty quickly without thinking very much about it, because you learned it so well that it becomes a cognitive set, a perceptual set, and a motor set that you don't really need to think about. And if you think about it, it's a fairly complicated task. This idea of unconscious memory can affect us seems a little bit mysterious, but it's well grounded in research. While Freud was very nebulous about it and maybe overstated the power of the unconscious, we are affected unconsciously all the time, every day, in ways that we may not be aware. In fact, just talking to Jason beforehand, we were talking about a video you can see online where they ask people to watch a ball being passed around amongst a few people and how many times the ball is passed. And people watch that, and at the end they're like, did you see the giant gorilla go by in the background? And many people never see the giant gorilla go by in the background, but it goes by, comes back by, waves at you, and then moves on. It was there the whole time, but your focus was so intense that you didn't even pick up on that. So that shows how your conscious attention can actually preclude you from being able to process information. But on the other side, sometimes your unconscious memory will rule the day and operate on your behalf for the most part to help you through things. So you don't have to think about them all the time, and you can do other things. So procedural memory, perceptual, motor, cognitive skills required to complete a complex task. And we use as an example learning to run a cash register, where at first it's explicit. You have to learn each key and where everything's positioned and how to run it. But the more you get comfortable with that, eventually there's a point at which you can just engage in transactions and pretty much make unconscious movements that are correct by keying in certain items, because you're that well familiar with the procedure, which requires perception, motor, and cognitive skills. Conditioning memory harkens back to the material we covered in the learning chapter in classical conditioning, but particularly with operant conditioning, because we do things that we're so conditioned to do without conscious awareness that sometimes escapes our notice. So conditioning memory, information stored that's automatically recalled to help get new information better and faster without conscious processing. It's hard to unlearn these, and I gave you an example before. For example, when you enter a password in, you probably just enter in the password. Right? You don't really think about it until they make you change the password, and then you have to unlearn something that has become so conditioned that it's reflexive, and relearn something you create anew. And eventually you will learn that well enough, you'll be conditioned, you're reinforced every time it works, and you're punished if it doesn't work. So you extinguish some learning and you facilitate the adaptation of learning a new thing through the processes of conditioning. And so the implicit order that we're talking about will have a lot of implications when we get into social psychology. We're going to talk about schemas more explicitly here shortly. No pun intended. Explicit. Nah, you don't even get that. All right, explicit memory. We're going to talk about schemas more explicitly, but our schemas operate oftentimes without our awareness, and they shape what we see, and they shape what we don't see. They shape what we hear. They shape what we don't hear. But more importantly here, it shapes what we remember and what we don't remember. And we can actually reconstruct memories without being aware that we're doing it, such that we create false memories or distorted memories that seem so real to us that we would never say a person was lying, but more that they were distorting their memories in a way they weren't aware of. That's just a bad graphics blurry. But long-term memory breaks down into two major categories. Explicit memory, which we call declarative, by definition requires conscious recall for me to say what I did yesterday or say what I did the day before, right? Episodic would be saying the things that happened to me personally in a situation. Semantic would be factual knowledge about trivia or about rules or ideas, things that I could talk about consciously. If I want to talk about, for example, governments and types of governments, that would be semantic memory, because I would be able to remember types of governments and have a debate based on my memory of those different types. Implicit, non-declarative memory. Memory does not require conscious recall. Although it can be brought to consciousness, it is typically going to operate on autopilot, so to speak. Procedural memory and conditioning memory are subtypes of this. So that we do things that we get really good at that require fairly complicated procedures, but they become so well learned that we don't really think our way through it, we just do it. And conditioning memory is very similar to that, automatic conditioned responses such that we don't realize what we're doing. And if we wanted to use the behavioral example again of a police light coming on while you're driving behind you at night and you getting the butterflies, right? That's what? Classical conditioned. It's automatic. You don't think, let me have butterflies. That's a conditioned memory, right? And as you hit the brake seemingly automatically, you now know that's operantly conditioned, right? And that operant conditioning seems to happen without me thinking, oh, let me hit the brake. So it happens implicitly. We could then bring it to conscious recall if we want to, but it doesn't operate with consciousness being a requirement. In fact, by definition, it's unconscious until we bring it forth.